number three, and then Mark and Betsy will anchor group number four. And we're gonna do some counting off to get into these groups, and then we're just gonna make our way to a table that will hopefully be large enough. We might need to do some shuffling and moving around of furniture to accommodate everybody in our groups. Is that clear?
Yep.
Okay, great. So Carrie, do you mind starting counting off?
Two.
Three.
Four.
Great. Five.
One.
Oh, one, sorry.
Do you all, okay.
Two.
Okay. Do you wanna, okay. Three.
Three. Four. One. Two.
Three.
Okay, and up here, Susan. Four.
Four.
Okay, Seth.
Five, I guess.
One.
One.
Yeah, right. I'm with you.
Back in the back.
Three. Four.
One.
Two.
And then back here.
Three.
Four.
One.
Two.
Three.
Four.
One.
And Todd, did you already go?
I did.
One. Okay.
All of the imagination.
Two. Three. Four.
One.
Two.
Three.
Four.
One.
Two. Great. Three. Four. Great. So I'm going to say group number one with Morgan and Claudia. We'll go over to that table where Morgan is. Group number two with Nicole and Ebony right here. Group number three with BJ and myself over here. And group number four with Mark and Betsy back there with Mark. Okay. All right.
Sorry, did you say that group number six is going to?
This is group number three.
Three, great.
Three.
Yeah, I think so. First, maybe just a quick go around.
My name is Matthew Fugardi. I direct the Art of the World, known in Minnesota.
My name is Vera Amir. I'm from New Orleans, Louisiana, and I'm from a New Orleans theater ensemble. I am last call
of the Brands Technology Project. Vera Amir, co-artistic director here at the Theater, originally from Buenos Aires.
Jeff Freeman, technology director here at Double Edge, originally from Minnesota. We got time.
Yes.
And I'm Javiera, Ethics and the Common Good, Hampshire Commons.
Mod London, School of Drama, University of Washington.
I'm Jennifer Galley from the Berkshires, a little town called Millerton, working with some visual artists actually who are building community.
Vijay Matthew with HowlRound at Emerson College in Boston.
David
Boulder.
Any lingering or percolating questions, comments, and reflections?
Well, I guess it's about the language people use and how you get, how you even just broach the whole idea of this. And when you say collective or alternative, everybody just goes, oh, you're over there, let's get on with the world. So what do you find is helpful?
I've had these issues 10 or 15 years ago where my liberal friends would say, it's just not marketable, it's not a good message. And that's the slippery slope down to simply not achieving your goals.
Right.
And so I find that having the hard examples are the best way to neutralize that. Because ultimately you're trying to create a whole different mental construct, and there's no substitute for doing that, or at least having those cultural norms in place. But I agree with you, some of those words, you know, people say, oh, it's communism. But of course the state's not involved. So, you know, and so you have a lot of these pitfalls, but a lot of other people I encounter say, and are immediately positive. I think it's just an acculturation process.
Start with the negative examples like Monsanto and the seeds?
Well, that's why I start with enclosures, because people relate to and understand the enclosures. And then from that into the constructive and positive alternatives. That's, I guess, another way that I try to talk about it.
Interesting, because I feel like I was hearing a lot of what Carlos was saying about a lot of these, you know, this is like a total inversion of my way of thinking, and so, and a lot of the structures of that, the enclosures, you know, are very deep, and so I think it's interesting that we're here at Art and Survival, because us starting with that kind of conversation is more like lots of very deep revisioning or deep doing inner work, because I don't know, I feel like it is, it's like a very, it's a huge thing to tackle, you know. That's kind of like my walk away with it. I'm like, wow, it's big, huh?
But without, I mean, it's big precisely because the problem is systemic.
Yeah.
And it reaches down to our inner being, but it works at this macro level, too.
And that was the problem.
So.
Don't you think also that the money and the vocabulary play like a parallel role, like they're both instruments, or being used as the instruments of the imposition of this other system that we're sort of like debating? So we need to be like extremely careful about the words. And I also think like it's important to the educational needs that you're talking about is crucial, but also I think that there's something about the physical actions or the actions, like working on the land together without necessarily talking, to create that different, or I'm just using that example, but it's not the only one. Playing football together, like in the streets, like I think a lot of the football in Argentina is that. Is a response to the others.
Once you get enough of these divergent examples, self-identifying as commoners, you start to see kinship and affinities, and it becomes a culture unto itself. And I think that's partly what the building strength, that's how you build strength, by having this shared culture. I mean, the seed people are facing the same problem as the software people. In terms of enclosures of their what belongs to them. So why shouldn't we have a shared language despite radically different domains?
But also a lot of the cultural activities suffer the same, like the you know, the painters being locked out from the galleries, or the theater, right, not being able to be produced outside of the systems. I guess one of the things you're trying to do is to tell people it can be done in a different way. Yeah. But immediately everybody tends to not imagine that.
I think it's ultimately this profound personal and social paradigm that people's imaginations can't get beyond a business startup. You know, that's the way you solve a problem.
Or in some ways entrenched systems. So for me, the HowlRound example is a great example of success, because what, you know, my history of it is that, you know, those of us who were looking for some sort of alternative system and another way of sharing information and getting other more voices into the conversation, we're hitting our heads against both an institutional theater system and its magazine, essentially, which I've been a part of for 100 years. But what happened with HowlRound, despite the sort of grating against that system for a long time and being seen as an upstart in challenge of that, it has now defined the conversation in a mere 5 years in the theater community, opened it up to hundreds of people who've never been part of it, and now the institutional system is reaching back to HowlRound and saying, help us do what you're doing, because we can't do that.
I'm wondering if this is a good opportunity to ask Vijay to speak a little bit more about the project, and I'd be really interested in hearing about, one, like, lessons learned as in doing this, and then also just questions and challenges that you're actively wrestling with that you don't have answers to yet.
I think the biggest lesson I've learned, just kind of living with this evolving commons, is that I really learned that people's personal intentions, you know, most people in our field are liberal, progressive, and they can have wonderful things that they say and feel, but the power of the institutions that they live in, and our institutional theater, our not-for-profit theater for the most part, the ones that are medium-sized, large, are kind of mini, adopt the kind of behaviors of for-profit corporate behavior that's just ingrained. And the way that people decide to be administrators or managers or producers is, it's not really different if they were working in a for-profit realm. And they bring these this mindset into the nonprofit realm, right? And so a big, huge lesson is that, in a way, the HowlRound Commons has been foisted without really people knowing into the field, and it has radically changed the behaviors of large institutions. An example, very concrete example, is that 5 years ago, or 8 years ago, or I guess 5 years ago, you wouldn't ever see a theater promoting or talking about another theater's work in a completely unselfish way. Like, I'll give you an example. Hey, I'm a theater company in California. Check out what Mixed Blood Theater in Minneapolis is doing with their radical hospitality initiative about giving free tickets or allowing anyone to come to their shows. Just that, you know, very simple behavior was unheard of. And I think it's, I think it's the system of the commons and the way that it's changed social relationships, that that these large institutions have the potential to have the same voice as someone who 5 years ago no one has ever heard of, that there's that equalizing force. And I think that this open invitation for people to become peer producers in these platforms, that mindset is, we're going to make the assumption that everyone has potentially something to contribute that's of great value to the overall community. And that's a very different mindset than the pre-commoning field that we have. So big lesson is that it's really the structures that we live in enable our best behavior to come out. And no matter if we're stuck in an institution that doesn't enable that or promote that, we're kind of screwed no matter what we really want to do with ourselves.
So my take on that, on what you've said, which is incredibly moving, is that as we sort of move through this particular field with all of our deepest desires and wishes to be good and collegial and all those things, we sort of eject some of those things along the way, even though we may not tell ourselves that. And that what your example has given the field is the ability to say, oh, they're doing exactly, we can't do radical hospitality, but we're part of that. You know, we can't open our magazine to everyone's voice, but look, they're doing that, and look at the conversation they're generating, and it allows us in a way that may even be a little marketplace co-opty to kind of own a piece of the goodness, do you know? Is that accurate?
Absolutely. That there's this shift, a mindset shift of people feeling like they can actually participate in collective good and a collective mission for the overall field, where that existed less before this commons.
There's a great example of the Buffalo Commons in the Midwest Plains, where these sociologists say, let's just create a Buffalo Commons. And it was a somewhat fanciful thing, but the term put in play this cultural orientation that pretty soon you had ranchers talking to land trusts, and people were sort of entered the proto-commoning just because the term was put in play. You know, I just am reinforcing what you're saying.
And then also practical behaviors around just resources, that has shifted. For example, HowlRound TV is an example. It's a shared technology that we as a HowlRound staff administer on behalf of the field. Anyone can live stream on it, and it's self-selecting what gets live streamed. So for the most part, people know that if they have something that they feel can benefit everyone else in our field, then they'll live stream. So it's very rarely used for, in the old model, a self-promotional kind of thing. People are live streaming events, conversations that are useful for everyone. And in the fact that you can actually share this kind of technical infrastructure is a huge radical departure from the older kind of corporate, for-profit, enclosed model. I need to own this channel, it's got to be super branded us in order for it to be effective and to be something that our organization can even consider using.
So Vijay, what would you say the role of imagination is in your work?
I think it's, the role of imagination is just, I think, really figuring out how we've internalized for-profit behaviors, being aware of that, and then reconditioning ourselves, all of us, and re-educating ourselves, and really questioning every kind of given impulse that we may have about how do you run an organization and how do you serve the field. And, I don't know if that leads us into how do you make your art, but definitely how you support your art. But definitely how we run arts organizations.
But don't you think that those things are interrelated?
They are.
Like, how do you produce something that is like this is different than how you produce something like in an NGO? So you need to think imaginatively.
I mean, Carlos, you could probably talk to this about ensemble theater versus, for the most part, the well-funded not-for-profit theater is a freelance, completely market-driven freelance system where everyone is freelance. And that's a completely different way of making art. And so it seems very natural to adopt for-profit behaviors when your not-for-profit system is just set up to produce art in this particular freelance market.
It's expensive in big urban areas and relies upon huge audiences, so it's self-perpetuating.
I have a thought and a question, which is that it's interesting the example that you gave about how, like, 5 years ago, theaters weren't sort of cross-promoting if they didn't have something to gain from that, because it's the thing that people say the most about New Orleans theater, like when they people who come from from New York or from San Francisco, from wherever, come to New Orleans, meet the community, you know, intermingle with us, and the thing that they often say is like, oh my God, it's so supportive here, like it doesn't feel competitive, and I think that there's something underneath that that comes from we already know that we kind of don't have enough. Like, we already know that our resources are super limited in New Orleans. Like, we don't have, 90% of our arts funding comes from out of state. Like, we you know, as like small ensembles or like in competition on a national scale with people from bigger cities. And, so I think like because there is this actual lack of resources, it makes us behave in better ways. Where I think that like when you actually have enough, there's this like kind of, it's the capital mindset, right, that says like, if I share with you what I have, that there is then less for me, and like less for me now is really, you know, like I want to hold everything I've got for some like future that I'm imagining. And so even sharing the resources of our, you know, just like our, you know, publicity or whatever is seen as like dangerous or detrimental to our own work. But I think that that's not happening in places, or at least it's not happening in New Orleans. And I think it's really largely based on the fact that we have such a lack of resources. So I think that there's like that may be true in some places, and it's not, it hasn't been true for us. And I think that it comes from this, it's, we share resources because we have to, because if you need a soundboard, I'm going to lend you our soundboard. If you need three microphones, like we've got three microphones, you can have them, and like I'm not going to charge you money for them because I know that later you're going to help me edit the grant that I need to turn in or whatever. And there's this like true sharing economy that's based really really largely on need, right? It's not just like a fantasy based on some like ideals. It's like it's happening in real time and in reality, because otherwise you don't have your microphones, right? And so yeah.
And there's probably a lot less resource inequality in New Orleans, where in other cities there's probably the bigger organizations that get all of the funding, and then
yeah, yes and no. I mean, certainly there are bigger nonprofits that have lots more access to resources, but maybe less than in other cities. I'm not sure.
I mean, it's interesting. I kind of work off that. As I moved to Minnesota recently, you know, it has, you know, probably it's like number one or number two in terms of arts funding for everyone. Really responsive foundations. You know, we've been doing, beginning to do like rural networking work with folks in Minnesota, while also doing it in Kentucky and Ohio, which have far less. I mean, the governor tried to destroy the Arts Council in Kentucky a couple months ago. And I have seen the exact opposite of that. And again, I'm going to paint slightly broadly, but the exact opposite in Minnesota, where there is like a total abundance of funding. And it feels to me that that abundance has almost cut off collaborations. It has definitely cut off innovation on some levels, you know, whether it's critical innovation or aesthetic innovation. So it seems to sort of reinforce where you were going with this, David, where like it's, these are all these nonprofits that are like, they're guarding us, like they're like.
All of my former colleagues are managing franchises, proprietary franchises, as nonprofits, as opposed to having the porous boundaries of collaboration. So obviously, no movement gets going based on that.
So just in terms, sorry.
I was just going to jump in and say, Charles, not my point. It's interesting though, because echoing what Jay was saying, I do feel like the conversations are shifting very, you know, slightly, but they are shifting. Like in Minnesota, I agree that we've had a history of there's a lot of conversation about like, oh, so-and-so is eating the funding, or so-and-so is taking from these people. And it's real, real true. But I've also seen like more funders gravitating towards collaborations and being intrigued by that, and this idea of cross-sector and all that stuff.
Yeah.
It's little by little, you know. I hear you.
Well, just in terms of human behavior, there's studies that show that people who have fewer resources, like people who live at or near the poverty line, are more willing to give, like to lend or to just like outright give, like a much like bigger percentage of their income to each other, right? Like if you needed $1,000, I could lend you $1,000, even if I only make 12 grand a year or whatever. Where people who make more money than that, like relatively speaking, are not going to be giving away 10% of their income to anybody else, or even lending that money. And so, I think that there's. Yeah, I'm really interested in the kind of like, what is at the heart of this, you know, like how are our individual behaviors, like where does that come from, that like sense of, that sense of not having enough, and how does, like even when we have enough, we still perceive ourselves as not having, as like being, living in lack.
Right, and then noticing for whom that's not as challenging.
Right.
Right, because I do think, I mean, for some people commenting is much more accessible. It's something that they have either have done at growing up, or their parents did it, so it's not so far-fetched. And I think for others of us, it's more far-fetched. It's like many generations ago, and I think it's just interesting to notice where you fit in that.
The social context and upbringing, some are more plausible than others. Mm-hmm. And people who have lived in a wealthy market context, that's, you buy it.
What do you mean by imagination in this conversation? Because it feels like part of what we're imagining is different structures, different or infrastructures. But I also, I guess I take the call to imagination also to mean some other kind of deep work that manifests itself as art. So it's a question for you.
It's a good question. I mean, maybe I'll just jump in and share some reflections, and maybe it'll get to that, and maybe it won't, and then we can go from there. So I'm working in a small liberal arts college, primarily with 18 to 22-year-olds, although there's a lot of other people of other ages in that context, mostly working. And I'm directing this program on ethics and the common good, and our mission really is to cultivate collaborative leadership, you know, for creating a more equitable and resilient world. So in thinking about, and I think, I mean, for me, imagination, at least in this context, when we're thinking about creating systemic change, has to do at least about imagining new possibilities and then finding ways to create those possibilities. And I think they are about systems and infrastructure, but I think they're also about relationships and ways of being. And I think they very much relate to the earlier conversations about mysticism and our relationship to land. It's like, who are we, and what are we doing here, and how are we living? So kind of with that in mind, and sort of as I started building this program in collaboration with other people, I think one thing I've realized is that there's a relationship between remembering things about ourselves and our capacity to imagine. I think that we have to create the right conditions for imagination. I don't think that those conditions just exist. And so in the context of Hampshire and in the context of the work I've been doing with young people who are really passionate about creating change, right? They have that passion and they're eager. There's some work to be done around creating the right conditions so that the way they go about it doesn't just reinforce or recreate the things we've inherited. And so, you know, we're totally experimenting, and I think that we're at the very early stages. But one thing that we experimented with last year was a practice, a storytelling and deep listening practice that sort of enabled people to remember and think deeply about who they are, where they come from, kind of what support has enabled them to get to where they are in their life, what choices those supports have enabled them to make, what impact they're hoping their choices make, right? So that it's clear, so that it's not just some sort of fuzzy thing. And also what values kind of are underneath all of that, like really helping folks get clear about what their values are and where they come from. And we've been doing that through a storytelling practice, not unlike the story circles that we did, although a little bit more codified. Like there's a series of questions that we ask folks to reflect on. And then we, and they do it in a small group and in a circle. And then once somebody has shared a story, we invite people to reflect back what they heard in a really specific way. So it's a practice that we call resonance, and it just invites people to share the moments in the other person's story when they felt the most moved. And so it's just this, it enables both the storyteller and the listener to really connect and really identify those moments of connection. And I think that that's been just a starting point of a practice for helping people remember things about themselves and recover their own story so that they're not just functioning in the world with the stories we're told about who we are and what we're here to do, but they're able to sort of reclaim their story and make meaning of it and connect it to what they want to do in the world and why. Why do the thing that you want to do? And so that's just something I've, and to me that's also a very liberatory practice. So I think I've been thinking about the relationship between imagination and recovering our imagination and creating liberatory spaces, right, where we can experience a fuller, more robust version of ourselves in relation to others. So I feel like all of that's kind of like, it's like pre-organizing, right? It's like, Over the summer, I had the opportunity to co-host a workshop in Holyoke, where I live, and Holyoke is a post-industrial city. It's very economically poor. It's like rich in people and possibility, but it's a struggling town. We had this cultural organizing workshop where we were really exploring, you know, the power of art and culture for community development and community building and change making. And we invited this artist, Ricardo Levins Morales, to speak. And he's a visual artist out of Minneapolis, Puerto Rican. And he does a lot of work around the medicinal power of art. And he talked about going to his hometown in Puerto Rico on the center of the island. Him and his sister, who's a poet, went, and they wanted to organize. They wanted to sort of connect with people and organize. They hadn't grown up there, but their parents had, and they had connections in the community. And they got there and they realized, you know, in all their enthusiasm, that a lot of stories hadn't been passed on, right? So the new generation didn't really have access to the stories of their elders, and those elders were dying. And so there wasn't a foundation from which to organize from. And so they realized what they needed to do was pre-organizing, which for them meant collecting stories and making them visible and sharing them and sort of inoculating the field, right, with the stories that would then enable people and give people the courage and the sense of purpose to create the changes that they wanted to make. So I think that there's a role that to me is related to imagination too, and kind of what's required, you know.
One thing that has been in my mind for the many, many years when I was at the Community Foundation and asking myself questions like, how can you really, you know, make lives of everybody better? Where do you start? And I think for me what happened was I began to answer that question with really young people, like young children. And so by the time I left, we were launching an initiative for children between the ages of birth and five, because the data now is that there are more and more children entering kindergarten with absolutely no stories. They've never heard the alphabet song. They've never held a pencil or a crayon in their hands. They enter kindergarten with eager teachers who are faced with this huge learning gap and vocabulary gap. So as everybody, we were all talking, you know, about this issue. I'm always looking for ways to fix the world. And I thought, wouldn't it be great to have a fabulous children's story that, you know, was all about these different kinds of values, of caring about somebody else and of wondering how you can work with your tiny friend and build something together. But, you know, building a narrative that is based on a different set of principles that you're talking about, but in this very charming, attractive way. So it's like we need a new Dr. Seuss. You know, so that all the parents, you know, read 100 times over to their child is this little book that is, that just prepares the way so that these ideas, like when you get them at the age that they are, they're ready to collaborate. And my guess is if you ask people, your kids your age, I mean, the age that you're dealing with, is, you know, who are they, where do they belong, what do they want to do, it is about generosity and about caring. It's not about, I want to extract as much as possible from the world and remove myself. It's, I think, or at least I'm a deep optimist, that people do want to engage with each other in a way that is mutually supportive. So how do we start that?
I think it's the which starts now. Nowadays starts earlier, but I think it's the educational system, the whole system. Because you spend about 23, 24 years of training yourself to be in an assembly line, which is the opposite to imagination. So I had to be quiet, sitting, you know. So, you know, now because of the ADHD, and we started, you know, researching, or scientists started researching that. But to me, it's not ADHD, it's the natural tendency. A kid needs to jump, you know, and you're trying to hold them sitting and, you know, focus. And there's other ways of attention, not just one. So I do think we do have a systemic, and now it's aggravated by what you're saying. There's no grandmother. You know, I grew up with my grandmother because my parents were working, but she was, you know, I learned a lot of things from her. Mm-hmm. Basic things, including how to cook.
It's good that Double Edge is going into the schools. Really good.
I also want to bring the schools here because it's very liberated. Because here we then open and we just run. We go to the forest and, you know, it's a day with no, that structure, you erase the structure because the structure is as powerful or more powerful than the language. So, you know, it's a, you know, Foucault compared the school system to the jails and the military camps. And I think architecturally, but also behaviorally, like it's acquired. It's not like, no, but I agree with you. I'm an optimist. I think everybody wants to be generous. But if you're trained every day to take, you know, to take and to be careful, you know, this is my answer. What did you take? You know, which that is so sort of encouraged, fostered, so you turn into that beast.
I wanted to go back to something that you brought up about the relationship of like remembering and imagining. So both of the projects that I'm working on right now have to do with like going back in order to imagine forward. The deck bar project, which I talked about a little bit earlier, I think is doing some of what you're saying.
Like, can you say something about that project for people who didn't know?
Sure. So it's an oral history project that has a theater. It's an oral history and theater kind of intersecting. So in 2013, the last lesbian bar in New Orleans closed, and so now there's no more gathering spaces for queer women, or at least no explicit spaces like that. And so we started, my collaborators started interviewing elders and women who had sort of come of age in these bars. And so these stories were really robust and really vibrant and just spoke to a really rich history that many of us had never, like, even though, you know, we had gone to these bars and had been part of these communities, we had not known the history. And so now there's this really beautiful kind of intergenerational thing that's happening where there's, you know, I'm 32, but there's people who are a decade younger than me who are involved in the project, and we're, you know, in collaboration with and building really deep relationships with these women who are in their 60s and 70s, and also otherly gendered people, not all of them are women. And so, you know, I think really for us, for those of us who are like the instigators in this project, the idea of having that history is so important to be able to ground into in order to envision a future that is sort of beyond what the bar, like if the bars aren't there anymore, then like what did the bars give us? What did, you know, and what do we lose when we don't have those spaces anymore? And if you don't know those stories, if you don't know what happened there, it's really hard to imagine forward that future. Okay, so that's one thought. The other thought that I'm having is that the other project that I'm working on right now is a new devised piece called Jubilee. That's it's white people, white Southerners dealing with white supremacy. And so I think that there's like there's this like really complicated feeling of like what happens when the remembering isn't pleasant. Like what happens when the remembering isn't something that you want to honor, right? Like I really, you know, with the Dive Bar project, it's like I can feel really good about most of the stories that we've collected, most of the things that we've heard, but when we think about like what it means to be like a white Southerner, like it's violent, it's brutal, it's ugly, and it's like those are my ancestors, right? People who have done horrible things and benefited from, you know, these systems. And so then how do we use also that remembering to imagine for a better future? Like how do we, and I think maybe the fact of how painful some of that is, speaks to a lot of why we can't get to that imagining, right? Because like for, I think for a lot of white people, it's really, it's awful to go back there. It's awful to connect yourself to that and to see yourself as part of this real lineage of violence and subjugation. And so, yeah, how do we enter into that?
It's interesting though, because one of the things that I heard you say, and I guess most of Jay's story too, is the sense of remembering who you want to be, or remembering yourself. And it seems like part of that painful and difficult exercise is about getting to that. That's the, I mean, I don't even know how you start this, you know, but the kind of like Pollyanna voice is like, well, then you remember who you want to be.
Yeah. I mean, I think just based on my experience this year and is that, at least in the context of the work I've been doing, it's been really important to do that kind of remembering who we want to be, but also in the face of whatever challenges we faced with other people, right? So to not do it by ourselves. And I don't know. I mean, I think that there's also space. I think I theoretically and practically, I think that there's a time and place to do personal work without others in the room. So I don't think that that's like, that should be off the table, but I think there's a real, something, new things become possible when you are in a group and where support is explicitly a value that you share and that you are sort of figuring out how to give to one another. In the face of like the pain and the challenges and the extreme discomfort that you might face. I'm wondering if anybody who hasn't had a chance to speak wants to say anything or has a question or reflection about what we've been talking about.
I do have a reflection. I think it's very interesting, everything that I've heard. I haven't like heard it all. But I do have a question about system, like a system of people, a group of people, how does it work? And for me, it's very interesting to be in this country because it helps me to see my culture. And one of the, I'm here because I'm doing my own project about female miners, a play. And it works in a very particular way, the miner copper system. And I compare it to this place, for example, like the US, and I think the Chilean culture is very dispersed. It's very, like if you do something or you make a mistake, it's like, oh, you make a mistake, then you can make another one. It's very like out there and like, it doesn't have order enough. So you can kill, in my country, you can kill someone and you might not go to jail. And that's like a fact. And a lot of women get killed like every weekend and like, it's insane. And I see this culture and I see the opposite for what I've seen in a very humble like position. It's very strict. Like if you make a mistake, you will pay for that mistake. You will go to jail, you will have a law. And it's the same, for example, like for kids that I see the timeout. We don't have the timeout. And it's like, oh, you have to go timeout in the corner. And they grow up in a very like, or obedient way sometimes because of that. And I'm thinking about like, how can I found a way that I can bring to my country and minors especially, that is a very like a jail culture. It's very like you're not, if we have an accident, a very serious accident with a truck, no one will say anything because you're a snitch. If you steal something and I see you, you won't say anything because you're not a snitch. So we will cover you. And I see in this culture that it's very open in that way. It's very honest in that way. Also very hidden in so many ways. But it's a question for me, like how can we create a system when everyone can talk and everyone can say something, or it can be some order that I can contribute. So it's like, thank you all for it.
I'm feeling the heat and the like end of day fullness. We have like 5 minutes before we need to close. our conversation and come back to the larger group. And so, yeah.
About just kind of the general idea of relationship between the commons and survival, and this survival of all of us, future.
Well, and the first thing that comes to mind is the Magna Carta was this armistice between commoners and the king over rights of access to the forest for their survival. So in some ways, it's quite literal. But I guess it's, I'm not sure what your question is, except meeting basic needs. Is
yeah,
that sort of...
in a way that... Well, maybe talking specifically about impacts of climate change and commenting as a way to somehow help with that and somehow.
I've grappled with that question because people say, "What does the commons have to say about climate change?" And most people think of big-scale solutions at the transnational or global level, which immediately involve the nation-state or international treaty organizations, which are dysfunctional and are not going to do it. So I've been trying to imagine really decentralized, local examples of commenting, especially for ecological things, and then start to build up and federate, especially through the use of online platforms. But that's sort of the challenge, I think, in terms of how do you incubate a new sensibility towards the earth on a big scale fast? I don't have a good answer.
I keep wondering about, too, in this political climate where we are now, where some people don't even believe in climate change, how do we, and especially all of you who are running theater organizations, or you're creating a commons for people, how do you host a conversation across that terrible divide? And
I think, well, here's an example. Some of you may recall the spotted owl litigation controversy in Oregon years ago between environmentalists and timber. The environmentalists won, but there was such polarization and the Forest Service had no consensus for administering the forest that they said, okay, we're going to convene a council of all the stakeholders and create, in effect, a commons for the management of the national forest, in which the forest...
The timber people.
Everybody, the developers, all the rest. And the Forest Service had the veto power and legal authority, but they had these intense, over the course of 1 or 2 years, council sessions of all these people. And there's a film about it that's 30 minutes long about the Sioux Law National Forest, in which they basically worked it through to realize each other's needs, because they were instead of talking at each other as caricatures, they had to deal with each other as human beings who in some ways had similar values or concerns. But in short, it was a hard negotiation, not in a political or economic sense, but in a human sense.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess that's a legal framework to
hold it. That's also true. So it wasn't just warfare. So that's not quite an answer,
but it's, it's possible if the structure, maybe it's breaking things down to a small enough level, as you say, and also taking one thing on at a time.
Because the big structures are not going to be transformative, and so it has to happen outside of those structures and push up on them. And so my strategic theory is build it sufficiently, with sufficient integrity and scale outside of the system, and then you negotiate with the system from a place of strength.
Or spotted owl councils.
But you frame that in terms of negotiation and not in terms of the power of example.
It's a functional alternative. It's kind of a moral rebuke.
The way Linux was a moral rebuke to Microsoft. Or the way local food is to agribusiness. Here's this viable, healthier way to do it, and you guys aren't doing it. So I think the example is also very good.
How do you feel like we addressed your question about imagination at all?
So much more. I think it's I mean, we're meeting, we're talking about activism, and we're talking about land narratives, and we're talking about spirit and mysticism and all these things, and I think we're focusing on systems and other ways of being and being together. And some of the examples, like the Dyke Bar piece, is a art-centric way, or when I saw Chip's pictures the other way, or when we see the way you guys are working and living here, those are the examples of imagining with artistic tools other ways of being. And so yeah, I mean, I just kind of want it all to work and all to happen all at once, and just to spring from our table, and then, and then the, like those beautiful pictures over there, suddenly the world is alive with awareness and feeling
and generosity and feeling.
So let's do that. We have a minute.
Yeah, totally. We're pretty much at time, so I'm going to call it and bring us back together. Yeah, thank you all so much.
We're regathering.
Yeah, it's a large group.
Oh, you have a large one. Okay.